Greetings in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and welcome to online worship with Ramona Avenue Christian Church. I'm Dr. Matt, and I want to welcome you to the second Sunday of Lent as we move through the purple season, this time of preparation, contemplation, as we prepare ourselves to be able to enter Holy Week, the Passion of Jesus, His death and resurrection. A few words about today's service. We'll be taking communion as always, so you want to track down some bread and something to drink. We'll partake together. This is the last Sunday of, or last day of Black History Month, and so you'll see that reflected in our music today. The credits, we're going to be revisiting Lift Every Voice and Sing once again, and our special music, Wes chose a piece from the film Rosewood. This is a film that's about the Rosewood Massacre that happened in January of 1923, so less than 100 years ago. This was it's been called a race riot, a massacre. An entire town in Florida, Rosewood, was destroyed, burned to the ground, and so there was a film in 1997 with music by John Williams, who's one of Wes's favorite composers. So he's playing a piece from the film called "Look Down, Lord," and then some other themes musical themes from the film also at the end. So I've included a little bit of information about the Rosewood Massacre itself and some clips from the trailer for the film, so you can kind of experience that a bit. And then I also give you the lyrics to that song, "Look Down, Lord." And then other than that, we have our kind of normal things in the service. We'll be singing a couple hymns and praying and all those things, the sermon and so on. One announcement, or actually a couple of announcements I want to make. A little update on the Congregational Singing Project. I want to thank you to those of you who sent me audio files for that, and I'm going to be working on putting those together and hopefully have those in sometime in the near future. I can layer together the various tracks that you've sent me, so thank you for that. One other one, and this is looking a bit further ahead, but thinking about post-Easter, after Easter, we have a few Sundays and then Pentecost, and then we go into this time of year we call Ordinary Time, which is, it runs for 20 weeks or more of the church year. And so usually try to think of a series of sermons to go over that teaching over that that period. And the two books that have come to mind to preach through would be the Psalms, and taking a whole variety of Psalms, looking at different ways that they address the different aspects of life. And then the other one that has come to mind, it would be to work through the book of Revelation. Yeah, I know, that book. but it's actually a fascinating book, and it actually has more allusions to other parts of Scripture than just about any other book. It's an often misunderstood and misinterpreted book, too. So thinking about those two options, so if you have a strong feeling or even a mild feeling one way or the other, if you'd rather have me preach through the Psalms or through Revelation, let me know. You can drop me an email, a text, put it in the comments here, and I'll see which way the wind's blowing, where the Spirit leads. All right. As we transition into our worship, I want to lead us in a breath prayer. And for today, in light of the scripture that I'll be talking about later, let's use the phrase, "Help us follow." Okay, so begin with a couple of deep breaths. And out. In. And out. help us follow. Help us follow. Help us follow. Help us follow you, Lord. Amen. Now let's join together in the Lord's Prayer in song.
Disciples, we're now in the season of Lent, a time of reflection and dedication. For many of us, we are used to the tradition of giving something up, but I want to encourage you to add something to your spiritual practice. It could be to recommit yourself to prayer or Bible study, to time for meditation, to reading something that will feed your spirit, to making more time in your day for personal devotion and time with God. During the month of February, Black History Month, I've been sharing on my personal Facebook page a reflection from Howard Thurman, the Black theologian and mystic who loved spending time with God. And so today, as we begin and complete the first week of Lent, I wanted to share one of his meditations called The Sustainer of Life. Hear the words of Howard Thurman. And as you listen, please know that I am honoring the request of the estate of Howard Thurman to use his original language, which may include masculine language and pronouns. The Sustainer of Life. It is of enormous reassurance to us, O Father, that Thou art the sustainer and the holder of life. That despite all of our own limitations and finitudes, despite all our weaknesses and failures, despite all of the soarings of our minds and imaginations and our spirits, always we come back to the deeply lying assurance that Thou art the sustainer of life, the holder of all creation, and the guarantor of all our values. This is of such overwhelming reassurance to us that we celebrate in simple words of praise this almighty grace. We offer on our part not merely the good deeds of which we are aware at times, not merely the concerns for our fellows which simply lead us to simple deeds or glorious acts of self-sacrifice, but we offer thee the things that we might become. All of the possibilities of our lives, the potentials not yet realized. We offer to thee our failures also, those times when something breaks down and we do not know what, or when something breaks down and we do know what. All that we might have been at a particular time and were not. All of the sense of conscience that disturbs and whips and tortures because we have not been in quality and in kind what we knew at the time we could have been in quality and kind. And beyond all those expressions of ourselves, our Father, we offer to thee ourselves. This is what we want to do, and sometimes we are able to do it just to say to thee, Father, here am I. My life as it is, at its depth, I give to thee. And I want thee to hold it so that it is no longer my life to do with in accordance to my whims, my impulses, my desires, or even my needs, but to take my life and to hold it until it takes on thy character, thy mind, thy purposes. If thou wilt do this, and if thou wilt help me to do this, then I can be in myself what is truest and surest in me. And this, O God, is all. Amen.
So, church, we have reached a very strange stage of this pandemic. We just passed 500,000 deaths in the United States from this virus. 500,000. Over 500,000 people have died. It's a number so large, I think it's hard to even get our minds around it. But by now, probably every one of you watching this knows somebody who's died from this, or knows somebody who's died from it. And there's a really good chance you know somebody who's had it. If nobody else, me. On Facebook, I'm posting a one-year-on journal of symptoms and what I was going through a year ago. So it's been making me reflect on the toll that this pandemic has taken, the toll that it has taken on us. At the same time, though, over 50 million people now in the U.S. have been vaccinated, at least the first dose, against this virus. And so we're in this really strange place now where so many people have died and it's still spreading almost uncontrollably. And yet people are getting vaccinated. Millions of people are getting vaccinated. And so there's that light at the end of the tunnel. And so we're in this weird in-between time where it's like we can see the end, but we also know that we're not there and it's going to be a while. Maybe a few months, hopefully not much more than that. It's so strange. It's a strange place to be, a strange time to be in, because it seems like, aha, we have a way forward. But it's still coming. And in the meantime, things are still dangerous and people are still dying of this. Many of you, I know, have already been vaccinated, at least one dose. A few of you, maybe two at this point. A few days ago, Jenny and I got our first dose, our first jab. But it's such a weird situation that we find ourselves in with the vaccine, even, because the reason we were able to get our first dose is that we live across the line, the county line, into San Bernardino County. And in San Bernardino County, they've moved on to the next tier, which includes educators. And that's why we were both able to get our shots. But I know Los Angeles County, which is where our church is, has still not moved to that, and they will soon. Actually, I think tomorrow, possibly. But they'll be moving to that next tier. But it also points out the patchwork nature of this whole thing, that depending on where you live, what part of the country, what state, what county even, you may or may not be eligible for a dose for the vaccine. And we also look around the world and we see that the inequities of the global systems, right? That there are many countries much poorer than us that are going to have to wait, and it's going to be maybe a long time. There's countries who are expecting doses and aren't getting them because of supply chains and them being taken up by rich countries like ours. Now, don't get me wrong, we have probably about the worst outbreak in the world. We've had the most deaths, and so vaccinating people here is going to really help everybody on the planet. But you got to wonder about the inequities of it and the way that much of the developing world is having to wait. I did hear recently, though, that the U.S. government is pledging $2 billion to help spread the vaccine all over the world, try to get it to poorer countries. Hopefully we can do better than we have done in the past with that kind of thing. So again, we're in this weird space, and many of you are probably itching to get out and to start to do things and see people. And even being vaccinated, you're like, is it okay to do this or that? And still have to be somewhat careful, because they don't know. You may be fully vaccinated and still able to pass the disease along, and they don't know that yet. It hasn't been studied enough. It prevents you from getting sick, but it may not prevent you from spreading the virus to others. So it's hard where we are. Other things to be thinking about in our prayers is, this is the last day of Black History Month for this year. A lot of people point out that Black History Month gets the shortest month of the year. It's not even leap year, so it's only 28 days, 4 weeks exactly. But it is important to honor the contributions that Black Americans and Black people around the world have contributed to society, contributed to the world. And to remember how that has not been easy and how it hasn't gone well. We'll have our special music after the prayer time here. And it, in a way, I was realizing it kind of brings together Black History Month and Lent all in one, because it honors the struggle that Black people have gone through in this country. And I was also reflecting on the fact that the Rosewood Massacre, which is what the piece is connected with, happened in 1923, when my grandmother, who only died less than 10 years ago, she would have been about 3 years old, I think, two or three years old. But her mother, my great-grandmother, who I knew, who was alive, she died actually just before I went to seminary. So, I mean, she lived to be 100. But she would have been in her late 20s when this happened. I mean, so this is not that long ago, less than 100 years ago, just this absolute race massacre. And part of what we do in Lent is we remember our mortality. We remember our sinfulness. We remember our humanness, our limitedness, and we repent. We pay attention to what we need to repent from, and we as a nation need to repent from our racist past and our racist present. Shifting gears quite a bit, Another thing you can keep in your prayers is our church, our church facilities. In fact, we just discovered we have a pretty major water leak, and we're having to have some work done, laying new pipes and things, and it's going to be expensive. Although not as expensive as the first bid, which was like five times more than the second bid. Different ways of approaching the problem. So you can be praying for our church, our congregation, that we can get the work done and that it can be done quickly and without too much disruption, because we have a Head Start preschool that rents space from us, and they're in session, in person, distanced and everything. But fortunately, it sounds like they'll be able to do the work without having to shut off the water and disrupting the school. So here we are once again. Let us pray. God, we come to you, the one who knows all, who sees all, the one who is related to all. You know us better than we know ourselves. You know humanity. You know the evil in our hearts. You know the corruption in our souls. Holy Spirit, root that out. Guide us toward better ways of living. Help us to see the value in valuing one another. And God, we mourn for the many, many who have died in this pandemic. Comfort those who are grieving. Help those who have lost loved ones. Bring people around them, virtually or otherwise, to provide strength and support. God, we also mourn the many, many lives that have been lost to the pandemic of racism. The pandemic of brutality, discrimination. God, forgive us as a nation and help us to find our way to repentance. God, I pray for each and every person watching right now, participating in this service, God. Breathe a fresh breath of your Spirit into us. Revive us in our souls and our spirits, and help us to follow you. Because without you, how can we even follow? So in the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
scriptural selection this morning is from Mark 8, verses 31 to 38. Then he began to teach them that the Son of Man must undergo great suffering and be rejected by the elders, the chief priests, and the scribes, and be killed, and after 3 days rise again. He said all this quite openly. And Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. But turning and looking at his disciples, he rebuked Peter and said, "Get behind me, Satan, for you are setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things." He called the crowd with his disciples and said to them, "If any want to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake and for the sake of the gospel will save it. For what will it profit them to gain the whole world and forfeit their life? Indeed, what can they give in return for their life? Those who are ashamed of me and of my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of them the Son of Man will also be ashamed when he comes in the glory of his Father with the holy angels."
So, church, it's the second Sunday of Lent. And last Sunday we saw how Jesus' journey began with his baptism, but then immediately going into the desert. It got hard really fast. And that sense of difficulty isn't going to leave us this week. This week we come to this passage in Mark's Gospel where Jesus begins to tell them that he's going to suffer, and he's going to be rejected, and so on, and he's going to be killed, and then he's going to rise again. And Peter, being Peter, who loves to jump in there, right? He's the one who jumps out and walks on the water. He's the one who blurts out, you know, you're the Christ, the Son of the living God. Here he blurts out, takes Jesus aside, it's like, no, that's not how it's going to happen. And Jesus turns, looks at the disciples, and he says, "Get behind me, Satan." Talking to Peter. Ouch. Imagine that, Jesus calling you Satan. Ah, that hurts. But it's the way he says it. The words he uses that I think are really going to be key here. Because it literally, he says something along like, let's see, where is it? "Depart behind me, Satan." Something like that. It's like this, it has to do with be behind him. He's like, go away behind me. Like, just get out of here behind me, right? Depart behind me. And then he says, you're setting your mind on human things, not on divine things. I'm sure Peter thought he had his mind on divine things. Like, no, the Son of Man, the Christ needs to triumph. Wouldn't we love that, right? I mean, this is the second coming, right? We want Jesus to come in the clouds with power and just set the world to rights. Like, we just want things fixed. God, just break in and do it. And Jesus says, "Depart behind me. Get away from me. Go back there." That's not how it's going down. That's how people think it should go down, but it's not going to go that way. Ouch. Well, then how is it going to go? If that's not the way, if that's the way that makes Jesus say, "Depart behind me," then what? Well, then he calls the crowds together. He calls the crowds over and he says, "If anyone wants to follow behind me," yes, the same phrase, except this time it's follow behind me instead of depart behind me. But the behind me is, it's exactly the same phrase. Let's see if I can find it here. Oh yeah, here it is. Episomoi, right? Episomoi, behind me, right? So he basically is making a contrast here, right? There's a contrast here between, on the one hand, Peter's idea that, like, no, you are not going to die, and that whole thing of suffering and all that path, is that's not the way. And Jesus says, depart behind me, get away from me. Whereas he says, now, he turns to everybody and says, if you want to follow behind me, you see the difference, right? It's like one is you're going away behind somebody, like you're behind them going the other way, right? You're facing that way. If you're following behind it, you're facing the same direction and you're heading, but behind him. He's like, if you want to do that, if you want to follow behind me, then deny yourself. Take up your cross and follow me. And the cross, maybe I don't need to remind you this, but the cross was like the gas chamber or an electric chair. It was the firing squad, the hangman's noose. This was the symbol of execution by the state, the power of the state to destroy your life. Take that and follow behind me. Deny yourself. And then he goes on, of course, he says, those who want to save their life will lose it. But those who lose their life for my sake, for the sake of the good news, will save it. And then he goes into this whole thing of, you know, does it, how much good does it really do you? What does it profit you if you gain the whole world, but then you die? What can somebody give in return for their life? Those who are ashamed of me, Son of Man will be ashamed of them. But back to this distinction between departing and following behind Jesus. I think probably most of us, at least, who are participating in this worship service want to think that we would want to follow Jesus. We are trying to follow Jesus. We want to follow Jesus. And yet one of Jesus' closest followers is told by him, get away behind me. You can leave. Just get out of here behind me. Because he didn't recognize the cost, right? How much are you willing to give to this journey? What are you willing to sacrifice? What are you willing to give to this journey? You deny yourself. Now, this has been used, I want to acknowledge that this has been used as kind of a weapon in the church, saying that there are certain people who need to deny themselves and submit and all those things, right? Women need to deny themselves and be selfless and giving and serving in the church. Minorities need to pipe down and deny themselves. Take up your cross. Come on. Trying to throw off your cross? That's not the way. While people who look like me have not denied themselves, have clung to power and held on to it. So I do want to recognize this passage and passages like this have been used as weapons. And I really think that Jesus would see that and he would look at us who weaponize these passages and he would say, depart behind me, Satan. You have your mind on human things, because you're clinging to power, you're clinging to privilege, you're clinging to whatever it is, right? You're thinking that you deserve fill in the blank. When what you deserve is death. What we deserve is nothing. Life is a pure and utter gift from God. If it weren't for God, we wouldn't be here. If it weren't for God, we wouldn't be alive. We wouldn't be doing the things we're doing, and we wouldn't have any of the things we have. And when we forget that, Jesus says, "Depart behind me." And then he goes on, "If you want to follow me, if you want to follow behind me, then deny yourself. Take up your cross and follow me. Lose your life for my sake." And I don't know what that looks like for you. I'm not even sure I know what that looks like for me. I mean, I'm sitting here in the fancy stole and the robe and everything. You know, I say things and people pay attention because I have, you know, degrees and years of training. And what does it mean to deny ourselves? What does it mean for me to deny myself and to follow behind Jesus? I mean, the whole image of following is that you're not the leader. That you are one of many. One of many. And maybe what it means to be a leader after Jesus, to follow after Jesus, is to help other people to follow as well. It's not about leading, being in the front, but it's about coming alongside people, helping them to follow Jesus as well. Hopefully I do some of that. What does it look like for you to deny yourself, to take up your cross and follow Jesus? What does that look like? I don't know. I'm asking. I'm honestly asking. Because I don't know your life as well as you do. Of course, God knows it better than either of us. What are we willing to give to this journey? What are we willing to give to the inbreaking inauguration of God's kingdom? Of what God's reign will look like in this world. What are we willing to give to that? What is God calling us to give to that? I mean, I could start listing things, you know. Is it your time? Is it your money? Is it your privileges? Is it power that you have? Is it skills that God has given you? I mean, what are the things that we give to this journey? Kind of a short sermon today, because there's, I don't think, a whole lot more to say. I mean, this is the gist of it, right? Jesus calls us to follow behind him. And when we start grabbing onto our human ideas and our human power and our human, all our stuff, he says, "Depart behind me. You're not following me anymore. You're doing something else." How do we give to this journey? Deny ourselves and follow Jesus. Let's pray. God, we come to this passage and we're at a bit of a loss. What does it mean to deny ourselves? What does it look like? How does that play itself out in our everyday lives? God, help us to see ways to prioritize your kingdom and your righteousness and your goals. Help us to follow behind you. Help us not to depart from you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. As we prepare ourselves to come to Christ's table, I invite us to sing together, Nearer My God to Thee. And we'll sing verses 1, 2, 4, and 5 of Nearer My God to Thee. So let us sing. Welcome to Christ's table. In this Lenten season, we are called to reflect on our humanity, on our mortality, that we are dust and that we will return to dust. We are called to reflect on our sinfulness and to prepare ourselves during this season to observe the final days of Christ's life, his passion, and ultimately his resurrection. We come to Christ's table, which is a reminder of that most intense of moments when Christ met with his followers, gathered around the table, and while they were at table, he took bread and he gave thanks. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam, hamotzi lechem min haaretz. Blessed are you, Lord our God, ruler of the universe, who brings forth bread from the earth. And he gave it to them, saying, take, eat, this is my body, broken for you. Do this to remember me. And then he took a cup, and again he gave thanks. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam, borei pri hagafen. Blessed are you, Lord our God, ruler of the universe, creator of the fruit of the vine. And I tell you the truth, I will not drink again from the fruit of the vine until I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom. Let us pray. O Lord, in this Lenten season, open our eyes to the world around us. Open our eyes to our own limitations, and help us to prepare and to be ready when the time comes to observe your life, death, and resurrection. Pour out your Holy Spirit on these gifts and on us as we partake. In Jesus' name, amen. This is the body of Christ, broken for you. This is the blood of Christ, shed for you. Thanks be to God for the gifts of God, for the people of God. Our hymn of invitation today is Where He Leads Me. And so this is the song that talks about us following, tying back to our breath prayer at the beginning of the service. Where He Leads Me, I will follow. I will with Him all the way. And this is our opportunity to commit ourselves and recommit ourselves to following Jesus wherever He leads. So let's sing. Thank you. may God be above us, to watch over us. May God be beneath us, to lift us up. May God be ahead of us, to lead us. May God be behind us, to push us. May God be beside us, to walk with us. May God be within us, to love us forever. Amen.